How do you make a good Metroidvania? As a fan of the genre, it's a question I ask myself quite often. What makes some work, and some just feel like pointless backtracking and busy work? Maybe it's how they handle said backtracking, or how often they introduce new tools for the player to play with. However, there's one key aspect that I think a lot of Metroidvanias overlook: the story. Now, the genre is primarily known for having very simple stories. You're either dropped on an alien planet or some creepy castle and are expected to find your way through. That's not to say there's anything wrong with this type of story, but there's really so much more you could do with storytelling in the genre. Iconoclasts is a perfect example of this. Iconoclasts is a story-driven Metroidvania developed entirely by one person, Joachim Sandberg, also known as Konjak. The game took 7 years of development to make, taking elements from several scrapped Konjak projects, including Mean of the Pirates and Ivory Springs, two short games that eventually become the basis for what Iconoclasts is. Also, apparently, his brother is the guy who directed fucking Shazam. That's not related to anything, I just thought you would want to know that. Iconoclasts is a dystopian adventure game that plays heavily into its themes and even more heavily into its story. This story is then held up by well-written characters that genuinely feel very human. I can't talk about much more without going into spoilers, so consider this your official spoiler warning. If you want my verdict on the game, it's great, it's amazing, you should go play it. If you've already played it or have no intention of doing so, then let's get into Iconoclasts. Oh yeah, one last thing. Since there's no real chapters in the game, I've taken upon myself to break it down into my own chapters, based on important story events. Some might be longer or shorter than others, but I've really tried my best to take it down to manageable chunks. And with that, let's get into Iconoclasts. We're introduced to our protagonist, Robin, a young mechanic living in a fringe town named Blockrock. One day, Robin's woken up by a rumbling close to her house, and immediately sets off to investigate. The first thing you'll notice is that movement is very fast, and flows into other actions very well. It never feels bad to shoot midair or mantle to grab a ledge. The other thing you'll notice is that jumping is super quick, and the air control is very tight. Along with being able to run and jump, you also have a stun gun that's your primary means of defense. The stun gun is a quick laser pistol with some limited auto lock. It can be charged to deal more damage and destroy barriers, but this puts it on a fairly long cooldown. Dealing with some monsters and running through the woods near her home, Robin finds the source of the rumbling, a demolished house with a hole in it. Without thinking first, Robin jumps into the hole and comes face to face with a strange contraption with an eye on it. The machine starts to attack Robin and thrust into our first boss fight. Now, the Saw is a fairly simple boss that I hesitate to even call a boss, but it does introduce you to some important game mechanics. This game heavily rewards you knowing the enemy's patterns, as you don't have much health, especially when playing on hard mode. The Saw itself slides up and down the arena and jumps a few times. It won't cause you much trouble, and you'll probably beat it first try. After defeating the machine, Robin heads home, but notices something strange when she gets there. A one concerned van parked outside her house. Robin heads inside and meets Agent Black and Agent White, two enforcers of the One Concern. Now, the One Concern is the tyrannical monarchy that rules this planet. They enforce occupational restrictions, thought policing, and religious absolutism. They're able to do this through their complete control of the world's ivory supply, so nobody can really disobey them. Ivory is a liquid fuel that's used for many things. It fuels everything from batteries to war machines to even houses. It's viewed as very pure, and by extension, most machines are viewed as holy. The two agents are here investigating claims of Robin being a mechanic, a very heinous crime given the holy nature of machines. However, are unable to find anything and leave empty-handed. As soon as they leave, Robin kicks up a loose floorboard and retrieves her wrench from the basement. The wrench is going to be your main puzzle-solving tool. You can use it to crank bolts, which can help you open doors or power machines. It's also a decent weapon, too, with you being able to tap it for a swing, or hold it for an extended spin. The spin can parry projectiles, and the swing does alright damage, so if they get too close to you, don't be afraid to hit them with a wrench once or twice. Heading into the town of Blockrock proper, we see how the common people of this world live. Fear is rampant, and no one is ever truly happy. Here we also meet Leticia, and while she won't show up much in this video, I'll be making a bonus video talking about her quest. It's super interesting, but it doesn't really slot well into the main story as it's completely optional. In town, Robin meets up with Elro, her brother and a chemist for the One Concern. Elro needs something in his family home fixed, and with his limited rations by the Concern, he doesn't have the money to hire a proper mechanic to fix it. While Robin is fixing up Elro's house, Elro gets into an argument with his wife. Elro isn't home very often, and he rarely gets to see his wife and child, and this clearly has caused some strain on their relationship. Elro can't exactly just get another job, as the concern completely controls all employment, but they're barely making enough to get by. Right as Robin is about to finish the job, the agents burst through the door and catch her in the act. For the heinous crime of being a mechanic, Robin is thrown in prison, and Elro's house is destroyed, with him and his family inside. We see as the house collapses, with all of them being crushed inside it. Robin is then thrown in prison. In prison, we're introduced to Mina, a young pirate woman who shares the same cell as Robin. Mina has had enough of being in jail, and uses some seed from her pocket to destroy one of the cell doors somehow. She grabs a conveniently placed shotgun and tries to make her escape. With no other way out, Robin decides to tag along, and the two of them try to escape jail. Also, according to the game, Mina fucking smells. But hey, if you look like that, you don't need to smell good. Please, queen, hit me up. My DMs are always open. I am begging you. Seeing through the vents and breaking out of prison, Robin and Mina are almost able to escape. However, on the way out, are spotted by one lone, one concerned soldier. The soldier on his own wouldn't be too much of a hassle. However, he quickly hops in a giant war machine named Kerthunk. It appears that Robin and Mina are gonna have to fight their way through him if they want to get out. Now, Kerthunk is the first real boss in the game, and as such, he's fairly easy, even on hard mode, which I recommend for anyone playing the game, even if it's your first time. He alternates between summoning minions and firing these large spark projectiles. The minions might seem bad at first, but they can actually drop health pickups to restore your health in case it gets low during the fight. Eventually, after enough attacks, he'll expose his weak point, a bolt that you have to wrench in. This allows Mina to shoot her shotgun and deal damage to the boss. Do this enough times, and his brain will become exposed. And once you get to that point, it's simply a waiting game until the big robot goes down. With the war machine defeated, Robin and Mina try to make a getaway on Mina's aqua scooter. However, the soldier from before has survived, and throws a grenade at the scooter. Unable to get out of the way in time, the scooter explodes, and the two women drift out to sea unconscious. Things seem to be looking up once they're found by a ship captain, however, with no use for them, he quickly dumps them overboard again. The next time we see Robin, she's woken up alone in an unfamiliar land, completely separated with Mina. With no way to go but forward, she heads further in, hoping to find Mina, or at least, a way to escape the concern. Heading further inland, Robin finds herself in the Shard Wastelands, the first real area of the game. Now, the Shard Wastelands is a massive desert, with several types of enemy that you won't even be able to damage at first. The game also introduces a few new kinds of puzzles here, some of which are used throughout the game, and others that are never used again. These spinning gear puzzles have some decent potential, but you really don't see them beyond this area. There's also bomb platform puzzles, which we'll cover a bit later. In the Shard Wastelands, Robin is also introduced to the Chemico Contra, a rebel group of scientists working to bring the One Concern down from within. They're a bit timid at first, but eventually they warm up and teach Robin how to craft tweaks. Now, as you explore the world, you'll find materials in chests. These materials can then be used to craft tweaks, which are minor buffs that go away if you get hit. You can craft up to three, and they provide a variety of effects. You'd think this would be a major game mechanic, but it's not really used that much. There's some interesting ones, sure, but them going away when you take damage ensures that you'll rarely ever get to use them on boss fights. You're honestly best just crafting three of the ones that give you an extra hit and being on with your day. Further into the Shard Wasteland, Robin finds her way into a One Concern weapon stockpile. Here she gets confused with an actual One Concern mechanic and has to help some soldiers sort out some chemicals. These soldiers are handling very dangerous chemicals, like X and Triangle. There's just a little minigame where you have to crank the gear to take the soldier to the correct level. Don't immediately crank the gear to the top because it takes a while to come back down. The speed will get faster and faster, but it's never too unmanageable. After helping sort out some chemicals, Robin's rewarded with the Bomb Shot, the game's second weapon. Now, the Bomb Shot is good. It's almost too good. Yes, it has a cooldown by default, but that doesn't really matter because you're gonna be one-shotting pretty much any normal enemy in the game. Anything that doesn't get one-shot by it is usually too slow or too passive to even hurt you, so most encounters become one bomb per enemy. It also has better range than the stun gun, and its charge shot fires a missile that can take out enemies from far away. At this point, the stun gun is relegated to the occasional puzzle solver and doesn't get much use besides that. The bomb shot is also used for puzzles throughout the game, being able to destroy red rocks and move these green platforms. The green platforms only move when you explode a bomb on a certain side, so you have to be at the right angle to push the platform. Keep in mind the delay between firing the bomb and it exploding. You do have a limited amount of time to reposition once you fire. After getting the bomb shot, we cut to a man in a cowboy hat having a debate with another man. The two of them are talking about the nature of the One Concern and human unity in general. The cowboy argues that the One Concern is just. Humanity has to be united, or else humans won't be strong enough to survive. The other man disagrees, however. He views human diversity as a strength, and says that the two of them will never see eye to eye on this. Upon hearing this, the cowboy promptly kicks him off a cliff to his death. The man's assistant, General Tolo, then introduces the cowboy to us as General Chrome, the leader of the One Concern army. Back with Robin moving through the desert, she stumbles across the young white-haired man. This man is from the One Concern, but shows no hostility to Robin. This is Royal, and he's the next in line to lead the One Concern. He's found a way to slip away from his entourage of soldiers, and seems to be growing flowers in the desert to bring a touch of life to it. He is wholly uninterested with the bureaucracy and leadership of the One Concern, and wants to use his powers for things he enjoys rather than serving an empire. Robin introduces herself, and the two of them quickly bond, looking at the flowers that Royal has grown. However, this moment is short-lived, as a pirate mech named Kibuka appears out of the sand to attack the duo. The two of them have no option but to fight it off. Now, Kibuka has a few phases. The first one has him shooting missiles from both above ground and underground. You aren't able to deal direct damage in this phase, instead having to rely on Royal to throw a rock at him. You can use your bombs to push Kibuka back into Royal's range, but you can't damage him directly. Deal enough damage and you go on to Phase 2. Phase 2 is largely a dodge gauntlet, with Kibuka changing sides of the arena often, and firing grenades to leave a shockwave you have to jump over. Pipe a few bombs into his gun when it shows up, and you'll deal enough damage to move on to Stage 3. Stage 3 is largely the same as Phase 2, however, Kibuka has now gained the ability to shoot missiles. These missiles explode upwards diagonally and shoot a fireball across the ground in hard mode. This is the point in the video where I need to talk about fireballs. Now, while I do recommend playing on hard mode, as it makes the game a lot more fair in my opinion, as you can't just tank boss damage, fireballs are one of the unnecessary annoyances you'll have to deal with. Some boss projectiles shoot extra little sparks on hard mode. These fireballs bounce along the ground for quite a while, and often feel tacked onto attacks that really didn't need them. Sometimes taking a hit is completely unavoidable. There's simply not an area of the screen you could go to avoid getting hit. After enough damage, Kibuka goes down. Royal praises Robin, and says that they should head to the One Concern camp in the desert so she can get the compensation that she deserves. Heading into the camp, Robin is immediately captured. Royal just didn't know that we were a fugitive from the law, I guess. By the order of General Chrome and Agent Black, she is to be executed then and there. Right before Robin is about to be executed, Royal saves her, knocking the ground out from under her and knocking her onto a train. The forces of the One Concern are in hot pursuit, and you have to face off against General Chrome and his assistant, Tolo. Now, despite this being the General Chrome boss fight, he doesn't do a lot of fighting himself. This fight alternates between machine gun fire attacking from above, with you having to duck under platforms to avoid getting hit, and Tolo throwing grenades that you have to jump over. These grenades are also your key to victory, as you have to reflect them back at the helicopter to deal any damage. Don't bother shooting your own bombs, I guess Tolo's bombs are just better. Dealing enough damage, the pilot decides to take matters into his own hands and attempts to chop you up with the blades like that guy in Indiana Jones. The second phase is even easier, with very telegraphed moves that are very simple to dodge. Either ducking, backing away, or jumping will do it. Just keep spamming bombs into the blades and eventually the helicopter will go down. As the helicopter goes down, Royal steps in to deal the final blow against it. However, inadvertently, he ends up mixing some very dangerous chemicals that we were sorting earlier, and the entire train explodes. Being knocked out by the force of the explosion, Robin is completely unconscious. Here we see a vision of Robin's late father, Polro. Polro talks about how he wishes he could have been there more for Robin, and hopes that she knows that he still loves her. There's some dialogue throughout the game from Elro hinting that Polro potentially took his own life. But we'll discuss this later. Knocked out from the explosion, Robin is found by Royal and Mina. Seeing the state his friend is in, Royal pleads with Mina to take her back home, and Mina has no objections. Waking up, Robin finds herself in Easy Lugar, the home of the Easy People, the group of pirates that Mina is from. The Easy People are a group of nomads that live in one big ship named Easy Lugar. Their culture is based heavily around procreation, with a lot of their idols being statues of couples, and a general attitude that shuns those who can't or won't reproduce. We're finally reunited with Mina, who also introduces Robin to her girlfriend Samba. This will be talked about more later, but this game has some very fantastic queer representation, and these two are just one example of it. Heading around town, Robin and Mina meet with Mina's crippled mother. Mina's mother tries to guilt trip her for not taking care of her enough, despite the fact that she is already well cared for by everyone else in the colony. She chastises Mina for leaving to see the outside world so often, and not settling down with a man from the colony. This is especially ironic considering we later learn that Mina's mother was an immigrant herself. After being able to explore Easy Lugar on your own for a bit, Robin and Mina catch up. The two of them begin discussing a book that Mina has been reading, and eventually doze off to sleep. When they wake up, they find that the one concern has begun attacking the colony. The entirety of Easy Lugar is in panic mode, and Samba sends Robin and Mina down to the labs beneath the colony to activate some mechanism that can help everyone escape. Before heading down to the lab, Mina talks to Robin, blaming herself for bringing the one concern to the colony somehow. The two of them then head off to the lab. Now, the Easy Lugar depths are where the water mechanics are introduced, and in the strong defiance of the genre norm, they don't suck ass. The omnidirectional movement is extremely smooth, with you being able to turn on a dime. You have a breath meter that's expended depending on how fast you swim, allowing you to pass through mundane areas faster if you know where the next air pocket will be. After solving some basic puzzles underwater, the two of them head down to the lab. In the lab, the scientists explain to Robin and Mina that they'll need several keys to reach the mechanism at the heart of the lab. Here we also meet Gustavo, an EC doctor. He's not important now, but he'll be a major story player later.
Hello, and welcome to the Los Pollos Hermanos family. My name is Gustavo, but you can call me Gus.
Now, the main form of puzzle in the EC labs are explosive block puzzles. Iconoclasts expects you to perform several smaller actions while under a time limit, which is oftentimes a platform returning, and it's not too punishing if you mess up. Some of these require a lot of precision, so it's good that the punishment is never more than having to walk back to the beginning of a puzzle. After making their way further into the lab, Robin and Mina discover the mechanism at the heart, which is revealed to be some sort of strange robot. However, a strange machine suddenly appears, similar to the one that Robin fought all the way back in Block Rock, and it takes over the robot, forcing them to fight it. Now this robot, named Inti, is a very fun fight where you juggle control of Robin and Mina. This is one of the unfortunately few times we get to play as Mina throughout the game. Mina has access to a stationary aimed shot and a very slow melee attack. You have to swap between getting the platform to Robin's side, cranking the bolt, and then dealing damage as Mina. As for the boss himself, his attacks are slow and telegraphed, and that's honestly fine. The challenge isn't the boss's moves, it's juggling between Robin and Mina within the right time. After defeating Inti, we learn a little bit more about the Easy People and the whole world in general. The planet we're on is not Earth. Instead, it's a planet that humans came to after depriving Earth of all its resources. The Easy People treat the vessel that their ancestors came in with great reverence. Every time a new couple is married, new figures are painted onto the wall of it. Robin and Mina share a moment in front of the shrine to Mina's ancestors. However, this is cut short when Agent Black and White show up. Agent Black decides to hold back this time, leaving the two of them to fight Agent White. Now, Agent White is the best boss so far. He's the first one with a unique theme, which is an absolute fucking banger, and he's the first agent we fight in the game. Fighting an agent head-on would be suicide. They're highly advanced super soldiers, so instead, you're forced to flee through several different rooms while he chases. This tests your dodge timing, and your ability to solve several small puzzles while under threat. Agent White has the ability to fire beams from his eyes, which take on different attributes depending on what pair of glasses he's wearing. Blue glasses freeze the area on impact, causing him to slip, and red glasses melt through steel and explode on the ground. Agent White chases the duo through multiple parts of the EC lab, using his powers along the way to try to kill them. Eventually, the two of them manage to trap him in a small room, and the real battle begins. He has multiple patterns of explosive beams and a dash grab, each requiring you to read them and react accordingly. Once his health bar is depleted, he doesn't outright die. Agents have the innate ability to heal themselves from their surroundings. However, Mina will stick him with a seed every time he does. Deplete his health bar enough and have Mina stick enough seeds at him, and eventually... And don't worry about it, I've walked off worse. After a short moment, the scientists begin to investigate Agent White's body. They praise Mina for finding out the seeds can kill agents, and then instruct Robin and Mina to go start back up the Inti, as there's no robots that can take control of it this time. Starting back up Inti, we learn that Agent Black and the rest of the One Concerned Forces have holed themselves up in the colony proper. You then play the short segment where you have to take out One Concerned Soldier throughout the entire colony. Upon reaching the top, Robin and Mina find Agent Black, fleeing with Samba as a captive. She called Robin and Mina monsters for what they did to Agent White, and threatens to kill Samba if any of them take a step closer. She then flees the scene with her hostage in tow. Determined to rescue Samba, Mina does one last check on her mother, who tries to guilt her out of rescuing Samba by claiming that she doesn't care if she lives or dies. Mina starts to internalize this and genuinely starts believing that she ruins everything, but Robin convinces her to still go save her girlfriend. The two of them depart into the world, looking for where Agent Black could have gone, and in turn, where Samba is. Before she heads out, the EC engineers take the liberty of upgrading Robin's wrench into the galvanized wrench. With this new EC tech, Robin can now ride on positive and negative rails, letting you access a lot of areas that were previously blocked off. Spinning the wrench now also builds up static charge, which you can use to travel across rails at high speed, breaking any blocks that are in your way. On their search for Samba, Robin and Mina head back to Block Rock, where they're stopped by Petra, one of the villagers that had previously shunned Robin's mechanic practice. She says that her son has been kidnapped, and she wants the two of them to find out who did it. Robin agrees to help find her son, and her and Mina head off into the woods near her house. A fun little tidbit, if you stop by Robin's house and go inside, Mina will ask to see where Robin keeps the naughty stuff, which apparently means her wrench. And if you are using a wrench down there, then I do not want to see what it looks like, that is a nightmare. Exploring the woods near Robin's house again, we're able to access a lot more of it. In this new part of the woods, Robin and Mina come across an abandoned house. Seeing a mysterious figure head inside, the two of them go in to pursue him. Following the man in, we see that he's trapped Petra's son, Pontus, in a block of ice, and is starting to question him. When the man in the armory notices Robin and Mina, he immediately starts attacking, and the two of them have to try to save Pontus. Now, the Hazard Armor isn't a boss in the traditional sense. He takes no damage and can kill you in about 2 hits. The real objective here is to break the ice block that's holding Pontus. Hitting the side with your wrench will be easy, but you'll need to set aside some time to ground pound the top of it to break it fully. Staying in the Hazard Armor's line of sight is fatal, so you have to duck and hide, only coming out when it's safe. Once Pontus is free, another man drops in from the ceiling. Robin's brother Elro, surprisingly still alive, comes in and tries to take out the man in the armor. Despite missing, he's able to knock off the man's helmet with his broken sword, the same one we see in his house at the beginning of the game. This prompts the man inside the armor to freak out, and says that he is heading back to the tower. We get a sweet reunion between Robin and Elro, but we still have some business to take care of first. After taking Pontus home, Elro talks to Robin again. He wants the two of them to go into hiding, far away from all the world's problems, but Mina says that Robin's old enough to make her own decisions. The three of them then meet Captain Myron, the captain who dropped Robin and Mina overboard back in Chapter 1. Despite not giving a lot of useful information himself, the three of them decide the best course of action is to break into a ship, to look for ways to get into the Farrier Shockwoods, where Samba could potentially be. After a quick snatch and grab from Captain Myron, the three head to the Shockwood, despite Elro's constant protests. As soon as the group steps in, a chemical contra scientist immediately warns them that the area is dangerous, and the One Concerned has been demolishing every house in the area. You'll find some very dangerous enemies here, some which you won't even know how to take out at first. The puzzles here are primarily built around electric charge. Spinning up your wrench will give you an electric charge like before, but this is useful for more than just riding rails. There's Tesla coil gates that will only open if they have an electric charge, and sometimes the spots where you have to stand to activate them can be pretty specific. There's also some puzzles where you have to break blocks with charged rail rides, but don't blindly do this because you do get punished for acting stupid. After heading through the Shockwoods for a while, the group decides to take a rest in an abandoned house. Immediately, Elro and Mina get into an argument about religion. This quickly turned into Elro making sweeping statements about the value of entire group's lives, and holy shit, you are making it so hard to root for you here.
That is right. You should leave this stage of history with dignity by inviting the other races to a great world war.
Suddenly, they hear a rumbling coming from below the house, and with just enough time, Elro is able to save Robin. However, it seems Mina wasn't so lucky. As soon as this happens, Elro starts to have a mental breakdown, saying that Robin isn't strong enough to do this. She should just be in hiding, and that if anyone's going to die, it's going to be him. We then cut to another Mina section, this time with her fighting her way through a bunch of guards before fighting another robot, similar to the one that Robin fought at the beginning of the game. This section is extremely fun. I mean, all the Mina sections are great, I wish we got more of them, but this one in particular stands out for not having the bomb shot that you're so accustomed to by this point. Using Mina's shotgun is a great way to mix up combat, even if it's only for a room or two. Now, if you thought the machine boss from the beginning of the game was easy as Robin, you should see how easy it is as Mina. His attacks are slow fire projectiles or trying to ram you. The second phase gets a bit more interesting with you having to knock it out of the ground with your gun, but besides that, nothing's really changed. Back with the brother-sister duo, Robin and Elro are making their way further into the shock woods. They come across a strange tunnel partway through, one that is apparently dug by one of the One Concern's machines. The driver taunts the two of them, getting Elro very riled up, before attempting to ram you with the drill. Now, this fight is very fun. The entire arena is circular, with you having to charge up and ride rails to avoid the machine chasing you. Its attacks are mainly summoning little drills and trying to ram you. The ram might get you a few times, but the enemies will always be there to replenish your health. Just keep firing bombs into the head and eventually it'll go down. Despite the main machine being destroyed, the pilot isn't done just yet, as he attempts to run over Robin and Elro with just the head. At this phase, Elro jams his sword into the machine's drill and Robin kicks it repeatedly. It's a fun phase too that's completely different while still relying on the same base mechanic of charged rail rides. Seeing Robin get deliver a high-speed kick to this robot is pretty nice too. Just when it seems they've hit it as much as they can while still being unable to kill it, the machine that Mina was fighting earlier launches up at it. And along comes Mina. After another snarky little back and forth between Elro and Mina, Mina rejoins the main party, and the three of them continue on their journey through the Shockwoods. Mina explains what she's been doing, fighting soldiers and that big machine, and Elro uses this as another chance to be an asshole to her. After some more bickering, the three of them finally head off towards their final destination, that tower that the man in the armor had mentioned before. Reaching the tower's door, we're reunited with another familiar face, this time being Royal. Royal says he's sick of the One Concern's ways and wants to show them inside the tower. Royal commands a troop of guards to take his guests inside, however, they instead arrest them, saying that a divine order from Mother has been put out for their heads. Mina gives a nice slow clap, and the entire group is thrown in jail.
Go fuck yourself. Go fuck yourself. Go fuck yourself.
Confined to cells with all their weapons taken, they immediately start to plan their escape, wondering how they can get out of this one. Robin immediately kicks open a vent in the floor and breaks out of jail. On the table just outside the cell, Robin is able to reclaim her wrench and searches for her other lost tools, which are held further up in the tower. Now, the tower is a mixed bag. A lot of the smaller room puzzles are very fun, but the main gimmick of having elevators between floors is more annoying than anything. Being forced to backtrack to an elevator miles away just because one isn't set up right isn't fun, it's just busy work. This isn't to say the area is bad, but it's just the weakest out of a very strong set in the game. The main gimmick of the tower is the elevators that go up and down. There's a few throughout the place, and only certain ones can access certain floors. To reach certain areas, you have to open a door from one direction, and then move the elevator up on the other side. As for the smaller puzzles in the rooms themselves, some more electricity puzzles along with the occasional bomb puzzle. While climbing the tower, Robin runs into Swordsman Silver, a super-powered samurai who you have to fight a few different times throughout the tower. His fights are all centered around reading his moves and parrying his sword. As you fight him more, he unlocks more moves, like a shockwave that'll force you to jump. His theme is also amazing, but that can be said for literally every single song in the game.
A summoner has disconnected.
Halfway through the tower, sneaking through a vent, Robin oversees Darland, a suit for the One Concern. He's testing weapons on someone, alongside the man that was in the armor all the way back in Block Rock. By his side is a performer who's cheering him on. Darland seems to be the no-nonsense type and gives very strict orders to his underlings. As for the strange performer next to him, we'll see a bit more of him later. During her search for her gun, Robin also runs into the Chemico Contra, who upgrade her wrench one last time. This upgrade allows the bombs that Robin shoots to carry the same electric charge that she does. While this might seem useless at first, a lot of puzzles require you to activate electric switches from far away, so this is the primary use for that. Talking a bit more about these puzzles, they feel like a more expanded version of the electricity puzzles, an already solid base is expanded upon with even more, so these puzzles are usually pretty great. After searching through the tower more, Robin finds her gun and is finally able to free Elro and Mina. The group then continues through the tower in search of Sampa. Partway through, they find themselves in a small room overlooking a theater. Here, they see a performance being put on by the performer they saw talking to Darland earlier. In a strange theatrical presentation, the man piloting the armor in Block Rock is deemed a sinner. Him daring to leave the tower is apparently punishable by death. The entirety of the audience, as well as the two performers, condemn him, and he falls to his death on stage. Riding an elevator back up after witnessing the performance, Swordsman Silver decides to attack the group again. This is simply a two-attack cycle of moving left or right or ducking down to dodge his attacks. Just fire enough shots up at him with the stun gun and he'll eventually go down. Further on in the tower, God, that feels like the fifth time I've said this, the group sees Darland again, but this time he's talking to another suit, named Farrier. Farrier says that nearly all usable ivory on the planet is used up, and that he, whoever he is, may sense it. Darland assures them that everything is going to plan, and they have more than enough time to make preparations. Finally, after a couple of hours, the group reaches the top of the tower. At the very top, Elro says that he wants to go in first. As he's still an employee of the one concern, his ID still works to activate certain doors. However, Elro tricks Robin and Mina so that he can go in alone and face Agent Black. Elro faces off with the agent to avenge his wife and daughter. After a tense few seconds standoff, Agent Black fucking shoots him. She reveals that these two seemingly have a rivalry even before this. She says that she is finally going to end this rivalry of them ruining each other's lives blow for blow by ending it once and for all, and rips off Elro's arm. Hearing screaming from inside, Robin and Mina break into the room and reunite with Sampa. It seems that Agent Black had been expecting us ever since we entered the tower. Just as she's about to kill Elro, Agent Black is stopped by General Chrome, who bursts through the door and deems that Elro is not guilty enough to be executed here and now. Black then pulls her gun on Robin, but Swordsman Silver slams her through the wall at the last minute, with Mina and Sampa taking the chance to get away. On their way out, Mina and Sampa free all the people trapped within the tower. Outside, the two of them finally have a moment to sit down and talk about what's happened. Mina says that she has to go rescue Robin, as she's her friend. Sampa admits that she feels like Mina only comes home just to say goodbye again. She's not asking Mina to give up on adventuring, but she wants her to find the balance between adventure and her relationships. Mina tries to get close to Sampa, but Sampa pulls away and heads home, leaving Mina crying outside the tower. We cut to another dream about Polro. He talks about how he should have been strong for her instead of being sad. He says that better things are coming before he cuts himself off. The dialogue in this section really makes it seem like Polro took his own life after being unable to handle the stress that was put upon him. Fading further into unconsciousness, the screen goes black, and it's unknown what has happened to Robin. When she wakes up, Robin finds herself in a dark underground cave with no source of light. Moving further in, it appears that Robin has fallen into some form of subterranean lab. The underground lab is closer to a mini dungeon than it is a full-fledged one. And this part of the game is essentially just a bunch of smaller areas as opposed to one big one like before. The puzzles in the lab are all about low visibility, and quite a few of the puzzles require you to lead possessed enemies to break blocks for you. They're all pretty simple, as this is primarily a story setup area. Moving to the lab, Robin finds writing detailing the one concerned experiments with the blue eye parasites. Trust me, I have a lot of experience with blue eyes, and yes, they are parasites. We find out that these blue-eyed creatures are called eyes. The eyes seemingly have the power to control not only living mass, but machines, and to some extent, the planet itself. You also might notice that the save statues look different here. That's because this lab was constructed under the rule of Father, the medium in charge before Mother. When Mother took the throne, the lab was abandoned and quickly overrun with the eyes. Partway through the lab, Robin runs into Swordsman Silver. It becomes pretty clear that he didn't save her from Agent Black out of the goodness of his heart, but simply because he wanted to be the one who finished the job. Reading some of the optional signs back in the tower, Swordsman Silver is described as cruel and vindictive, so it makes sense that he wants to be the one who kills Robin. Before he can, however, the eyes latch onto him, driving his cybernetics haywire as he disappears. After a few more short puzzles, power is restored to the lab. Robin runs into a now-possessed Swordsman Silver. With him in the way, Robin will have to fight her way through to make her way out of the lab. This boss, the possessed Thunk, named that way because it actually inhabits the Thunk machine we fought earlier in the game, is the hardest boss in the game so far. combining all the cybernetic powers of Swordsman Silver with all the strength of a war robot, all controlled by a deadly parasite, it's no surprise to see why. Silver will slash at you repeatedly and fire parryable projectiles. He also has a jumping slash that can be very hard to dodge if you aren't ready for it. He's also the main boss where the hard mode extra projectiles feel like a cheap source of extra damage. Some patterns have hitboxes over the entire screen with no real way to dodge, so taking a hit feels completely unavoidable. Dealing enough damage to Silver, or parrying back one of his projectiles, exposes the brain of Kerthunk. Deal enough damage to the brain controlling him, and it'll start to attack you directly, dropping control of Swordsman Silver. The Kerthunk will charge at Robin, and you'll need to use a bolt in the middle of the room to stun it with light, giving you a chance to kill the monster outright. Exiting the lab, Swordsman Silver makes one final attempt to attack Robin with the very last of his strength. However, it's stopped by Royal. Royal crashes down a piece of rock on top of him, trapping the swordsman underwater, where his cybernetic implants don't work, and he drowns, finally killing him. Royal is glad to be reunited with Robin. He says that he's sick of how the One Concern has been treating Robin and her friends. He's inspired by Robin's freedom, and tries to make some cute small talk, talking about how they both like flowers. He says that they can both help each other grow and teach each other about the world. It's a super cute scene that makes you forget that literally 30 feet away, a man is currently drowning. On their way out of the lab, Robin and Royal run into a Transcender, a device used to create the Transcendents. The Transcendents are a group of humans that have had their blood replaced with ivory. This ivory then infuses it into their body and gives them superhuman strength. Very few earn the right to transcend, and even fewer survive. Among those who survive, some lose limbs and organs, requiring new limbs and becoming agents like Black and White. Rarely, however, somebody stays intact throughout the Transcendents, and is chosen to lead humanity as a medium, such as Royal, Mother, and Mother's predecessor, Father. Destroying a Transcender is considered the ultimate sin. It's viewed as bad, if not worse, than killing a parent. Royal curses whoever destroyed it, and they continue on their way. Robin and Royal head further up the Darlin Descent to One Concern West, a base in the mountains. Royal says that here, he can work to clear the names of Robin and her friends, and hopefully get them acquitted from everything they've done. The Darlin Descent is the shortest segment in the game. All there is some minor electrical puzzles. There's not much to say about it besides the fact that you've probably guessed the naming pattern already. Every major geographic section is named after a One Concern suit. Darlin for the Darlin Descent, Farrier for the Farrier Shockwoods, and so on. This further goes to show the degree to which the One Concern exercises its control, naming entire parts of the world after people that are useful to them. Robin and Royal are blocked by Captain Myron's boat, which is somehow marooned on top of the mountain. Robin and Royal then go into the caves to meet with the man himself, and he has a bit to say. He explains that the world has no permanence. The landmasses of this planet are always moving, but it's still his duty to be the first one to map the whole planet. He explains that the answers they seek are below them, and sends them further down. Below them, Robin and Royal drop into the storage facility for all the One Concern's controllers, the power source of all their most advanced weapons. Royal is outraged that he was never told about this, and the soldier in the facility informs him that the entirety of the One Concern is out for his head. Royal deems the storage facility sacrilegious and tries to destroy it, but instead, awakens a machine named the Omega Controller. The Omega Controller is very unique, as its first phase is completely immune to damage. The screen scrolls up, and you have to fire grenades into the machine so it doesn't catch you. You can see here that the machine has the power to change the very environment around it, shifting between ones we've seen before. After moving far enough up, the Omega Controller decides to chase you side to side. In Phase 2, after fleeing back to where Captain Myron was, his boat crashes through the roof, and you mount it to attack the core of the machine. This fight is an amazing climactic set piece for Captain Myron's story, but it's not a very good fight. It's not very difficult, as the core only has one attack, and that one attack is a slow projectile that most likely won't ever hit you. After the Omega Controller is defeated, Royal feels ill, and wishes that there was something he could have done to help. He gets angry at Myron for not telling anyone about the machine. Myron posits his own theory that it would have been useless, as the machine is only a servant of a greater core device that is the planet. Royal refuses to listen, and launches the dead core into the sky to be rid of it. Finally arriving at One Concern West, now that Myron's ship is out of the way, Royal enters ahead of Robin and says that he will make a case for her and her friends. After Royal enters, Robin waits for him, but he never returns, and she has to look for another way in. Heading back down the mountain, Robin and Mina reunite. Robin explains her situation to Mina, and Mina says that Gustavo, the EC doctor we met hours ago at this point, could help them. Heading back, the duo finds Gustavo at the tower, helping any escaping students. After being told about the plan, he says that he doesn't know how to get in, but he knows someone who does, even though the chances are very slim. The three of them then head out to meet this contact face to face. In a secluded corner of the Farrier Shockwoods, Robin and Nina meet Ash, a former agent who defected, yet still holds true to the one concerned religious beliefs. Ash says that if the two of them can defeat him in a duel, he'll teach them how to enter One Concerned West, as he doesn't want them to simply go in and get killed. In his boss fight, there's a mechanic where you can switch characters by crouching and wrenching, a mechanic that will totally be used later, and isn't exclusive to this fight at all. For this fight, Ash is completely invisible, and can't be attacked directly. Instead, you have to hide Robin in the bushes and Mina in a puddle, because Mina is a woman that stinks good, and wait for him to reveal himself by walking, then dart out for a quick attack. Once you get in a few hits, he'll start to put a shield up in front of him whenever he gets attacked, requiring you to move the other character into position behind him. This fight's a lot of fun. The stealth mechanics are honestly pretty interesting. Positioning your characters around a boss that you can't hit directly is super fun, and I wish we got to play with Robin and Mina as a duo a lot more often. After being defeated, Ash tells us a little bit about his life. Here we learn more about the life of the Transcendents. Their bodies are always destroying themselves, but the powers of Ivory keep them alive, causing them near constant pain. Ash feels like his guts are constantly folding in on themselves. This also helps recontextualize Agent Black's headaches throughout the story as being more than just the result of people around her being incompetent. Ash explains that, due to the fact he survived, the One Concerned chose his daughter to undergo the same process. He tried to interfere, but admittedly to no avail. Gustavo also opens up here. He admits that he has a disease that will be spread if he reproduces, leading the EC to shun and ostracize him. He says that even if the gods are unkind and curse us, we don't have to be like them. We can help each other and make the most out of our lives. He provides pain pills to Ash to help him with the pain, and Ash acts as a good friend. Ash then tells us that the camera outside One Concerned West is broken, and they'll be let in if it doesn't detect them as human. With a stylish disguise, Robin and Mina sneak into One Concerned West to try to find where Royal and Elro could possibly be. Heading inside, Robin and Mina find the entire base staffed by robots, which is odd for a base this size. Regardless, they head on through the facility. One Concerned West is a good blend of old and new, with combat trials and rail puzzles mixed in with some new chain puzzles. Chains take time to be weighed down, making you think about how platforms and objects are going to move while you're waiting. While the chain puzzles don't really come back later, it's good for this section, as I feel if they stayed any longer, they would have gotten stale. As they head through the facility, Robin and Mina meet Tegan, a member of the Chemico Contra that closely knows Elro. We then get a flashback of Elro's past. Elro and Tegan used to work together at One Concerned West, both being members of the Chemico Contra back when it was first founded. Tegan asks what Elro is doing, and Elro reveals that he's invented a serum that completely removes any ivory from living organisms. This kills them instantly and turns them into dust. At this time, he has created two armed ones and one unarmed one that is completely harmless. Keep this in mind for later. Just as the two are talking, Agents Black, White, and a new one we haven't seen, Agent Gray, all walk in. Now, Agent Gray is Agent Black's partner, as well as the youngest agent. They seem to be the only person that can cheer up Agent Black, at least somewhat. Agent Gray heads over to Elro and starts to talk about work. They say that they're sorry for what happened to his father. Whether this sympathy is genuine or forced, we can't tell, but Elro absolutely can't stand it. Taking one of the armed syringes, Elro jabs Agent Gray in the arm. At first, nothing seems to happen. However, slowly, Agent Gray's body contorts and shrivels, before exploding into a mass of purple sludge. Gray dies in Agent Black's arms, with Elro escaping in the commotion while Black and White are in pure shock. We then cut back to the present day with Robin and Mina. Heading through the base a little bit more, Robin is able to find the Usurper Shot. The Usurper Shot is the final weapon in the game and has a heat mechanic just like the bomb. However, this one allows you to fire a few shots rather than just one. The Usurper Shot's charge attack allows you to swap places with blocks and enemies, giving you access to a lot more of the game. If the bomb shot is what killed the stun gun, then the Usurper Shot just pissed on its grave. Now there is no practical use for the stun gun whatsoever beyond breaking the occasional door you find every 3 hours. With the newly found Usurper Shot, Robin and Mina head further in. Deep inside, Robin and Mina find an ancestral vessel, like the one back at Easy Lugar. The Concerns seem to have taken this vessel apart for scrap, and don't hold the same respect for it that the EC do. This causes Mina to overflow with rage and swear to destroy the One Concerned for what they've done. Dropping past the ship and into the lower levels, Robin comes face to face with... fucking Blocker. This is a skeleton with a cowboy hat that wants to be Chrome so bad. He's shown up a few times before now, and now you have to fight him. He's really easy and just not fun. He doesn't really get a name like Kathunk or Kabuka, he's just Blocker. To defeat him, you have to blow up the floor below him and make him fall into these spikes with the bomb shot. To make sure you don't run out of room, you have to swap positions with the Usurper shot. The boss fights in this game are generally pretty good, but this kind of feels like a low point. Below Blocker, Robin and Mina find more Transcenders, and we finally see what happens to those who don't survive the process. To activate the door and progress to the next room, Robin has to trudge through liquefied humans to reach a key in a room that is an absolutely disgusting display of pixel art talent. After just swimming in human corpses, Robin is either too stunned to speak or really nonchalant about this whole thing, and the duo continue forward. Up a few levels, we come across Royal, who's being held in a holding cell. Royal's cell is full of detritus dust, the substance that created when all the ivory is removed from something. This is also the after effect of Elro's compound mixture. This means that in this scene, two of the three characters on screen have had to go through an entire room filled with dissolved corpses. Being around detritus dust deprives Transcendence of a lot of their powers, and renders them pretty weak. Royal yells that he's worth more than the train he destroyed or Swordsman Silver, and thinks that the fact that they locked him up here is completely heretical. Eventually, after gaining a bit more of his strength, Royal runs ahead of Robin and Mina. We now see a conference where Darland is speaking to the One Concern Army, with Chrome and Agent Black by his side, along with another man in purple. In this speech, Darland talks about the rocket being built, and says it'll just be another mining rocket and there's nothing to worry about. He hands the mic over to Chrome, who then reveals the One Concern's real plan. The elite of the One Concern plan to evacuate the planet and leave everyone here to die, as they believe there's no hope left for a future here. Chrome, however, is a man of the people and proposes a different answer. Chrome says that this is all Royal's fault, as Royal has angered the almighty him by destroying his creations. As Chrome wraps up his speech, Agent Black goes into a rage. Trying to talk her down, Chrome suggests that she still isn't over Agent Gray's death, and she proceeds to beat the ever-living shit out of him. We see here that Chrome bleeds white, confirming that he is also a Transcendent. Back with Robin and Mina, the duo are chasing after Royal, when they find a large room full of detritus dust. Inside this room, Robin and Mina find Royal talking to Agent Black. Royal wants to leave out on the next train to see Mother, and Agent Black says that that's not gonna happen, because Royal has ruined everything. Black calls Royal a perfectly sheltered child. He's someone who could have never ruled the world even if it wasn't ending. He had no hope of relating to people like Black, and even less of relating to people that he's supposed to rule over. It becomes very clear here that Agent Black doesn't work for the One Concern because she agrees with their worldview and philosophy, but just because it's her job to do so. She tells Royal that words don't change people, wounds do, and that it's time for Royal to finally become a man. Black then jumps on top of Royal and starts choking him to death. She taunts him as she's choking him out, but before she can kill him, Robin and Mina walk in. Black then reveals that it was her plan to wait here to kill Chrome, but seemingly everyone but him has found a way to her first. Mina tries to rush her, but she's knocked out cold in one punch. Black then takes off her coat and prepares to fight. Now, Agent Black is someone that's been hyped up all game. She's this mysterious central antagonist and has become sort of a rival to everyone in the main cast. So, does her fight live up to her excellently written character? Yes. Yes, it does. Agent Black always starts off the fight the same way, with a full-screen, undodgeable grab that reduces you to 1 HP, and kills you outright if you're under a certain health. To make up for this, the minions she summons after drop enough HP to make sure you live the next one. Between grabs, she alternates between slowly walking towards you and running like a maniac. If you get too close to her, she'll either attack with her mechanical arms or slam the ground. This slams out a shockwave that you have to jump over. Keeping your distance is definitely the right play here, as the shape of the arena will let you roll bombs into her, and her ranged shock blasts are far easier to dodge than her punches. After grueling back and forth, Agent Black finally goes down, passing out on the floor. Robin, unable to kill her, decides to leave her alive, while carrying Royal and Mina out of the room. After everyone is awake, Royal heals himself up in the next room, and reveals his final plan. He's going to make his final Hail Mary plea to Mother in the capital for everyone's safety. At this point, the group doesn't have any better ideas. They plan to make a stop at the jail that Elro is being held at along the way, and depart on the next train out. We then cut to Chrome and his underling Tolo walking around with a group of the now revolting soldiers. Suddenly, they're ambushed by the woman that Agent Black was talking to during the conference. She throws a syringe at Chrome before quickly teleporting away. Realizing what the syringe is, Tolo and the soldiers start to panic, but Chrome maintains his cool. The compound fails to kill Chrome, and he bursts into tears. Chrome has taken this as a sign that he is sent here with divine purpose. Even the weapon that can kill Aidens has no effect on him. Chrome is now fully convinced that he is some sort of messiah, a speaker of the people and the bridge between the human and the divine. Making a stop at the prison where Elro is being held, the group finds him trying to climb into a transcender. Seeing this, Royal makes a promise to the group to not only get them all acquitted, but to make sure that the agents responsible for this are put to justice. With Elro now in tow, the group re-embarks on the train, and soon reaches the capital. The capital is a shining city of white sealed by a large golden gate. Royal attempts to use his status to gain access, but finds out he's been outlawed from the city on order of Mother. The group then beats up the old man guarding the gate and walks in anyway. Besides a few very minor combat challenges, the capital is just a walk up to Mother. It's a very interesting set piece that gives us a glimpse into how the elite of this world live. The people in here seemingly don't even know of the plight that the outside world is going through. In the heart of the city, the group finds Mother on her chariot, tailed by two guards that look like Pyramid Head. Here, Royal makes his plea to Mother, and she acts like nothing is wrong. Even in the most dire of situations, she still wants to keep up the image of a perfect ruler. However, the more and more Royal pleads, the angrier she gets, and eventually she lashes out at him. She blames Royal for the world's inevitable death. She pins all the actions of the one concerned all on him, and he collapses at the shock of his own family essentially disowning and shunning him. Mother then sees fit to make an example out of all of us. She transforms her chariot into a cat and charges at the party. Mother's chariot here is named Oedipus, which is the same name as her pet cat. Now, Mother can't be damaged until she uses a specific attack, so this fight is all about surviving and optimizing damage during the periods where she can be hit. She has a charge that you have to swing over, an easily dodgeable tail slam, and a boulder projectile that Royal will occasionally counter. When you see Oedipus look like it's about to cough up a hairball, that's your chance to strike. Once you've rapid-fired into the cat's mouth, you'll be able to swap places with her, which will allow Mina to punch a seed into her, and the process repeats until the battle is won. With Mother bested, both the citizens of the capital and Chrome's army show up to watch the fireworks. It seems we've left the gate open for the traitorous general, and Chrome kneels down next to the dying Mother. He says that even though she destroyed this planet, he will be the one to help save it and guide the people into a new age. We then see Mother explode into a tree just as Agent White did. The Capitol Guard then fires an ineffective shot at Chrome, and as both the Rebel Army and the Capitol Guard start to raise their weapons, the group ducks into a building just as the Civil War breaks out. Waiting out the war, the group seems to lose all hope. Royal and Elro lay on the floor, and Mina reflects on her fate, as Mother's real cat tries to comfort her. With nothing better to do as the fighting clears, Robin heads deeper into the building. The Capitol building is just more combat sections. It might seem like it's getting repetitive at this point, but this section gives you time to think about what just happened. Mother, the leader of the One Concern, is dead. Royal's worldview is completely shattered, and Mina is losing her faith. Chrome has effectively declared himself a God King, and who knows what'll happen next. As Robin climbs up the building, she finds all the suits panicking, with Farrier shaking Darland as an unnamed suit is dead. Reaching the top, Robin finds that Chrome and Tolo have gotten there before her, and are confronting Father, the medium before Mother. Despite their enhanced physical abilities, Transcendents still do eventually age, and Father is now in a vegetative state in a wheelchair. Chrome calls Robin over for a talk, and thanks her for setting everything in motion. He talks a bit here about his ideology, a view that humanity needs to look at each other, rather than reaching for impossible ideals and unrealistic highs. He then pulls out his pistol and shoots Father in the chest, saying that there's always death in the wake of change. Chrome says that he will only take power until things are set right. Humanity can't rely on leaders to tell them what to do, and that all leaders have to eventually fade away. He asks Robin to let him kill her to set the world right, as she's become a leader in her own right. Suddenly, Elro walks in, telling Chrome to stop talking to Robin. Chrome seemingly shows empathy for Elro, and says that he can let all his anger out on him. Elro then walks up and stabs him with a vial of his compound. Believing himself immortal from the failed assassination earlier, he basks in this false sense of divinity, before starting to convulse violently, just like Agent Grey did. He begs Tolo in his last words, asking where the Almighty he is, before running onto the balcony and exploding, finally killing the traitor general. We cut and see what appears to be a small dot headed for the moon, before we're back with the main group. Elro informs Royal and Mina that Chrome is dead, and he says that if they're all going to die, he is going to die at home. Royal says that he's sorry for all the pain and suffering he's caused them. It seems like he has one last idea he wants to try, but he cuts himself off. Royal is seemingly starting to believe that all his ideas do nothing but cause pain and suffering for the people he cares about. The group leaves the building, setting off for home, one last time. Fighting through the remaining guards and fleeing the capital, along with taking Mother's real cat Oedipus with them, the group is able to get out on the next train leaving the capital. Heading back the way they came, they run into Tegan at the One Concern East train station. Tegan is the Chemico Contra from before that worked with Elro in the past. She says that people have been fighting over the rocket, and she's just making sure that they don't break the railways so that people can return home to their families. Everyone's been clamoring for a chance to board the rocket, thinking that it'll be one last chance to get off this planet. After all, we all know dying in space is a much preferable alternative to dying on land. Royal says that if they're all going to die, he wants to try one final idea. Back at the capital, he had the idea to take the rocket to reach the moon and play with the almighty him. But as he believes himself responsible for everything going on, he says he has no right to force anyone to go along with this plan. Everyone seems to agree that if they're going down, they might as well go down fighting. Everyone but Elro, that is. Elro hears that Robin wants to help and completely snaps, saying that they should all just go home and be with their families when they die. If he's needed, he simply won't do his part and will prevent the launch of the rocket. Tegan finally tells Elro what he's needed to hear for the entirety of the story. The world is bigger than just him. If there's any hope for humanity, then they have an obligation to at least try. Elro begrudgingly goes along, saying that he'll press the button to help the rocket launch. But he wants to do his part alone, in typical Elro fashion. The group then moves to put their final plan to save humanity into action. Robin and Royal will be the ones on the rocket, while Mina and Elro will be launching it from the ground. Before they split up, the group gives their final goodbyes, knowing full well that they might not make it out of this one alive. We then cut to three figures in purple receiving orders from the One Concern. These three are the Reborns, a group of agents in training, essentially. The man with the bandana and woman with a gas mask that we've seen before are Lawrence and Nobel, respectively, and the woman with purple hair is named Mendeleev. The three of them are given orders to stop the launch of the rocket at all costs. It's unknown at this point if this is the suit's last-ditch effort to maintain control, or one last act to fuck everyone over. Back with the main group, Elro and Mina have to head to their launch terminals. Here we get the last Mina segment of the game. Making her way through the facility, Mina has to destroy the last of the One Concern's robots, as the eyes are starting to take over all the security measures. There's a pretty short on-rail section where you have to shoot these dangling robots, and it's very fun. It just reminds me that I wish we had gotten more Mina sections, because honestly, they're all a good breath of fresh air. Eventually, right before the launch terminal, Mina runs into Mendeleev. There's not many words to be exchanged, and Mendeleev tries to stop Mina from launching the rocket. Now, Mendeleev isn't really the main threat in this fight. It's actually her arena. Her attacks are all very mobile and force you to reposition with the hopes that you'll fall into the electrical hazard on the floor. Her attacks are mainly aerial projectiles, dashes, or both at the same time. If you manage to hit her at the right time, you can knock her into the electrical hazard on the floor and deal big damage. But whittling her away with your shotgun also works just fine. This fight is a good little send-off to the parts of the game where you play as Mina. The fight is designed around her moveset, and feels very rewarding to play as such. Eventually, Mendeleev is defeated and retreats, and Mina now waits in the launch room for Elro. Back with Robin and Royal, they move through the facility and the final puzzles of the game. Looking back at all the puzzles in the game, we really did get a good bunch. None really felt unfair or needed some crazy moon logic, and most interacted with the environment in really unique ways. Good puzzles are something that's very hard to make, so I respect the hell out of Konjak for finding a way to make it work. Heading deeper, we find the last remnants of the Chemico Contra, who have been found out by the One Concern and locked in one of the test chambers. As soon as Robin is about to free them, Nobel appears and begins to flood the room with poisonous gas. Nobel seemingly shares Ash's ability for invisibility, but doesn't match him in direct strength. Throughout this fight, your health will be constantly draining. Nobel will take hostages, periodically revealing herself, and just like a real American, we will opt to shoot directly through them. You can knock Nobel out with these bomb tubes in the chambers, but just like Mendeleev, chipping her down is still 100% viable. On low health, she'll start to drop ghost mines, but these are all relatively easy to dodge. Chipping her down enough, Nobel is eventually defeated, and also retreats, and Robin and Royal are able to make their way further in. We now cut to Elro, and this is the first and last time in the game we have control of Elro. His movement is super slow, his jump is incredibly weak, and his attack takes 10 years to start up. Luckily, this segment isn't very long. I'll admit it's a little fun to see this one-armed warrior moving his way through the facility, even if he does it at a snail's pace. Making his way to the terminal, Elro takes out the last remnants of the One Concern army before coming face-to-face with Lawrence. Now, throughout this fight, Lawrence will talk about a man's place in the world. They're there to fight and to suffer. They grow scarred and calloused, but they will lead because they're the only ones that can. It may sound like some classic toxic masculinity, but as I'll go into later in the analysis, these are all things that Elro believes to some extent. As for the fight itself, it's all reaction-based. You either have to parry, jump, or crouch as he throws different attacks at you. Move your way towards him enough times and land enough glancing blows, and he'll go down eventually. As Lawrence goes down and Elro leaves, he turns back, stabbing his sword into Lawrence's back and leaving it there, killing him. He then continues on to the launch room. Once again with Robin and Royal, they make their way up to the rocket power station. As Robin starts to charge the rocket, a rocket launcher wielding Agent Black shows up. It seems she has been tailing them for a while now, as she looks disheveled and ready to kill. This fight is actually a little different, as the goal here isn't to take down Agent Black, but to charge the rocket. You have to move through three different floors to charge each of the three parts, all the while Black attempts to shoot missiles at you and beat you to death. Overall, it's a very fun change of pace that makes you focus more on the macro game of where Black is, then where to dodge each individual attack. Charging up the rocket fully, Robin and Royal make their way towards the launch platform. However, when they get there, they find that Agent Black has beat them to it. Black then speaks to the duo. She says defiantly that this is her rocket. She says that the One Concern has robbed her of her life, even the memories of what she had before the Transcendence. She lives every moment in horrible, sharp pain, and every time she's attempted to take her own life, they could just bring her back. The one human connection she actually had in Agent Gray was taken from her by Elro, who in her eyes has gotten off with this scot-free. Royal then talks to her, as a human being rather than as an agent. We learn here that her name is Madeline. Royal suggests that now that the One Concern is on his deathbed, her life can have its own purpose. However, it's clear that most of Madeline is gone, and Agent Black is all that's left. In a way, Agent Black is just like the Rocket. She's a tool that furthers the goals of the One Concern. But she's not going to be that any longer. For the first time in her life, she's making her own decision. And that decision is one final fuck you to the world that has treated her like shit. This is it. It's the final showdown with Agent Black. She certainly lives up to the hype of the occasion. Agent Black has a few different attacks. Some old and some new. Her rocket launcher from the last fight returns, as well as her melee punch from the first one, but they're both now much faster. She can now fire her rocket launcher in the air, and slam the ground to cause a shockwave. But by far her most dangerous attack is her electric slam, requiring you to read it pretty far in advance and inflicting tons of damage. She's the toughest boss yet by far, and took me many, many attempts to get down. As you deplete Agent Black's health, you'll get the chance to punch a seed into her, and she'll drain ivory fuel from the ship to heal. As she drains more and more, a tree sprouts from her back, just like Mother and just like Agent White. She moves slower, vomiting blood and becoming more and more enraged. However, eventually, Agent Black kneels at the center of the arena. As she continues to fight to her last breath, the eyes take over her body, sprouting the tree fully and finally killing her. Despite everything she's done, this moment feels incredibly sad. Madeline never asked for any of this. She's someone who was taken advantage of her whole life, and a few things that brought her happiness were taken from her. She was still a villain, yes, but you honestly feel for her now that she's gone. Robin and Royal head up further on the platform towards the rocket pod, reassuring themselves that what they did here was the right thing. The air is quite intense, when suddenly... Be honest, did you really expect her to go down that easy? The Ivory Beast is a challenge. Its attacks are fast, with little to no telegraphing, and its projectiles always move in a random pattern. You don't heal from the last fight, but the minions that it spawns do drop hearts. You can only damage it on a few specific bulbs, one of which is extremely hard to hit. Once all these bulbs are destroyed, the beast splits open to reveal a smaller form, and the fight continues up the rocket. Phase 2 is just like Phase 1, except all the melee attacks are removed, and there's a constant rain of projectiles. You have to balance between clearing the raining projectiles and dealing damage, all while not falling off the smaller platform. After a long-fought battle, the creature utters its final words, and with one last splitting headache, Agent Black is finally dead for good. Heading up into the rocket pod, Royal thanks Robin. He says that she's giving the world a second chance, and that he would somehow find a way to doom it again. He wants to ask the Almighty Him if he ever had a purpose, or if he was never really meant for anything. He says that he wants to make his own purpose. A purpose that can help people and create peace. Back at the laundry room, Elro finally arrives, but refuses to press the button. Seemingly learning nothing from Tegan and Lawrence, Elro insists that he knows what's good for Robin over Robin herself. He has the fucking audacity to walk out of the room, causing an enraged Mina to shoot him in the leg. I know this is supposed to be a grand overreaction, but Elro honestly deserves it. I'll talk about this more in the analysis, but Elro is a perfectly written character. That character is just a shithead. Back with Robin and Royal, the rocket suddenly launches. We see it exit the atmosphere, as the remains of Agent Black burn up and fall back down to Earth. Landing on a base on the moon, we get to see a bit more of the plan that the One Concern has envisioned. Personalized escape pods are present for all the One Concern's elite, including Madeline Benoche, or as we knew her, Agent Black. Only the elite were ever supposed to make it here, as George refused to open if they don't have the correct ID. Luckily for us, Royal is here, and he seems to be programmed into the system. Entering a glass observatory at the end of the base, Royal calls forth the Almighty Him. What emerges next is a monstrous leviathan, with the head of a bird and slender claws. This is he, the Starworm. Royal pleads to the Starworm for the safety of humanity, but he says nothing. As the beast stays silent, Royal gets angrier, being rejected by the very god that he is supposedly a delegate of. As he starts to leave, Royal attacks the Starworm, breaking part of its skull and angering the beast. He retaliates with some sort of psychic attack that leaves Royal crumpled on the ground. The Starworm then headbutts the glass, triggering the base to begin self-destructing, before flying towards the planet. Robin carries the now incapacitated Royal on her back, all the while Royal is talking about how he's nothing but a burden to everyone around him, and how he's the one who doomed the world. Robin pushes on through the facility until she comes across a broken door. The sensor for the door is detached, and there's no way he could get through in time, especially while carrying Royal. Robin has no choice. She has to leave Royal behind to activate the sensor while she makes it back to the escape pods. Leaving Royal behind, Robin escapes in the nick of time. As her pod leaves, the moon base explodes, taking Royal down with it. Despite all the bad things he might have caused, Royal's death is even sadder than Agent Black's. He never wanted to hurt anyone, quite the opposite. But nothing ever really turned out in his favor. Crash landing her pod next to her house, Robin breaks into tears. Mina, who was apparently at the house, comes to check out the noise and comforts Robin. She reveals that the Starworm crashed into the ground nearby, but Robin has no responsibility to do anything. She's given the world so much that she deserves a quiet and peaceful end. Heading into her house, Robin finds Tegan, Gustavo, and Elro. Here we find out that Tegan was the one who launched the rocket after Elro got shot. After a quick conversation, Tegan and Gustavo give their last goodbyes before leaving Robin and Elro alone. Elro has already given up. He thinks that the very notion of this plan was doomed from the start. He wonders if, when they die, he can see his wife and daughter again, and asks Robin to stay with him in the end. Of course, Robin can't just sit by and do that. Descending into the crash site nearby, Robin finds all the locations she's been on her travels. The Starworm must have some form of control over the planet, just like the Omega Controller did. The crash site is the last area of the game, with no puzzles and a few minor combat challenges. The game knows that at this point, the last thing you're thinking about is the minute-to-minute gameplay. Descending down, Robin finds the Starworm, injured and laying in the ground. Clearly Royal's attack did something to it, although not enough to stop it from firing the same beam that it did at Royal towards Robin. Robin is brought to her knees and trapped in her own mind. Here, she's forced to fight off manifestations of her friends and family. Rather than fighting them directly, Robin avoids them while charging bulbs, cranking bolts, and spinning cogs, all the things she's done throughout the game to help people. Now, this boss fight actually has a hidden mechanic, where some of the dialogue choices you make throughout the game can influence friendship, which makes this boss deal no damage. But the boss is easy enough to where it doesn't really matter if you didn't know about that. After facing off against manifestations of Elro, Mina, and Royal, we get a memory of a younger Robin. Robin is talking to her father, who says that he wished she would take up farming like her mother, saving her from a life of strife and secret rebellion. He doesn't want her to end up like Elro, someone who's full of hate and anger. You then get a choice. You can walk out or give him a hug. This doesn't really affect anything, but it's up to you if you can forgive Polro or not. Breaking free of the Starworm's control, Robin is determined to take down the beast. The Starworm has the power to manipulate the eyes and the planet itself. It fires bouncing projectiles and tears up the ground. Dodging and firing enough shots at it, eventually Robin goes in for a decisive strike, using her wrench to rip off one of the beast's hands. A little more damage later, and the starworm goes down. After the starworm goes down, the beast's head splits open, and out pops an alien pilot. The starworm was never the almighty him. It was simply a ship piloted by the real one in control. Despite not speaking her language, he shows Robin that the planet is nearly all out of ivory, and he has no use for it anymore. This pilot, the almighty he, is the final boss. He mixes in attacks from all types of boss. Being a mechanic like Robin, he also fights with a few tricks that we've been using. He has a large wrench and several similar abilities. His wrench fires electric blasts, and his stomps are explosive like our bomb shots. Despite his size, he can also move quite fast, so don't expect to get a lot of damage in at one time. When he reaches half health, he reactivates the starworm, and they both start attacking Robin. Luckily at this point, he doesn't have much health left, so he won't have to dodge two sets of attacks at once for very long. With a few more shots, he goes down, and drops to his knees. The almighty he then calls upon the starworm to kill Robin, but at the last moment, the ship malfunctions. Its remaining hand crushes down on him, killing him instantly. Robin then pulls one last seed out of her pocket. If the seeds have the power to turn ivory into life, what could they do to an entire ship made of it? With a punch into its skull, Robin jams the seed into the starworm, and the screen goes white. All throughout the world, the ground rumbles, as we see new life erupt from it. Trees sprout up, and a deer chases the soldier off a cliff, showing that the one concern has been toppled once and for all. Heading back above ground, Robin walks through the newfound wonder of the world before returning home. When she steps in, Elro says that from now on, he won't tell her what to do, and Robin takes the most well-deserved nap in history. As the credits roll, we see the new state of the world. Tegan and Gustavo watch the new life grow together. The Chemico Contra find new ways to power technology, not with ivory, but with electricity. The few remaining soldiers of what used to be the one concern, along with Tolo, mourn the death of General Chrome. But there's still work that needs to be done. Former members of the one concern still need to adjust how life works. The two surviving reborns are left with no direction in this world, though Ash might be there to help them. And at some point, surely, somebody will try to take control again. In the end, we see Mina and Samba reunited, sharing a kiss at long last. They hold hands in front of the ancestral Isi ship, ready to begin their new life together. As the credits fade, we see one last shot of a flower, the one that Royal grew for Robin oh so long ago. It's nice to have a moment to take it all in. The flower fades to black, and that is the end of Iconoclasts. Now, I absolutely love Iconoclasts, and chances are, if you sat through this video, you do too. The gameplay is fast and fun, the world is deep and interesting, and the characters are honestly some of the best that I've seen in a long time. The game spends a good portion of its time hammering in its main point, which you might have been able to guess from the name of the game. Iconoclasts is about what makes an unhealthy society, and the effects it has on people. This is then furthered with ideas of what needs to change, and how to enact these changes. For those of you who don't know, the word iconoclast is used to describe somebody who is critical of religious dogma. Somebody who tears down pre-established conventions to make something better. The whole concept of iconoclasticism is to oppose things that prevent any meaningful change, and that's exactly what Robin is doing. The one concern is a perfect example of a harmful societal system. The workers are kept on a tight chain by religious laws, while dissenters and foreigners are vilified or outright killed. Despite this, people seem to be attached to the system. They think of it as the only possible way for survival, as they're too busy trying to get by to have any time to think of meaningful alternatives. The whole system is inherently anti-worker and anti-common folk, but it's something that paints itself as a benefit. This is best exemplified through Mother, the metaphorical head of the snake. Somebody who projects an outer image of kindness, but then manipulates it to help her achieve her goals. She's a textbook egotist. If you have no value to her directly, then you have no value at all. This is harshly opposed by Robin, who is someone who goes out of her way to help those in need. She's someone who does this all without any reward or an expectation of one. She's a shining example of everything society should hope to achieve. Help for those who are suffering without needing to be rewarded or patted on the back. Most of all, Robin exemplifies a hope for something better. A hope beyond the system that life can improve. This is all set on a backdrop of environmental destruction caused by rampant resource abuse, religious absolutism, and some familial trauma. At the end of the day, while you could say these are all points of the game on their own, they all lead back to the same system that caused this issue. The characters in Iconoclasts are super interesting. Even beyond conveying the main message of the game as a whole, they each have unique individual stories that not only reinforce this main point, but expand the world into something that feels a lot more real. Mina is a great example of this. Her story shows you that it's important to cherish the bonds you have and foster them into healthy relationships. Never being there for those you care about gives them no reason to keep putting in work for you. She's someone who has to learn that you can't always be looking out for number one, and by the end of the story is a far more well-rounded person than she was at the beginning. Now, throughout this video, I've been very tough on Elro. This isn't because I think he's poorly written, it's actually the opposite. Elro was written to be kind of a controlling asshole, because that's how somebody who went through what he went through would react. His marriage was already stressed before we even saw it, his family died in front of his eyes, and his sister keeps running into danger. He views it as his responsibility as a man to protect these people, and he failed. As a father, a husband, and a brother, it's only natural that he would want to keep the few things he has left close. He doesn't care about how selfish it is or who it could hurt. He's been in pain for a long time, and he'll do anything to make that pain stop. Royal is probably my favorite character in the entire game. Someone who has grown up at the top, benefiting from the system, and is slowly exposed to its evils. For everything he did throughout the game, he was never malicious in any capacity. He genuinely believed that he could help, and that's all he ever really wanted to do. He wanted to be someone that people would look at for guidance, like how he looked at Mother for guidance. Even after recognizing the evils of the one concerned, that idea doesn't die. He wants to be someone that can be looked up to. And in the end, I'd say he's successful. Yes, he does die on the moon, but he helped his friends reach the Star Wars. He had a direct part in helping save society. And although he paid the ultimate price for being a hero, it's safe to say that he became the type of person he wanted to be. General Chrome is extremely interesting, as he serves as kind of a foil for what Royal is. While Royal wants to become a guiding figure to help humanity, Chrome believes that having any figureheads only holds humanity back. He takes a role as the King of the Everyman. But the King of the Everyman is still a king. Humanity will always have leaders. We're always going to look to somebody that we think is doing better than us, or somebody we want to be like. The issue isn't that leaders exist, it's the leaders we follow and their ideals. Agent Black is quite possibly the saddest character to look at. Madeline was somebody who lived her life in constant pain, until she met Agent Gray. She finally had someone who she cared about, and somebody who cared about her more than the concern ever could. For the first time in her life, she wasn't treated as a weapon, but as a person. In an instant, this was all taken from her by little more than random chance. Her hatred and anger for somebody she barely even knew filled her every thought up until her death. It's sad to talk about, and if there's anyone in the story that deserved better, it's definitely her. I'd also like to take a moment to talk about how both Mina and Agent Black are fantastic queer representation. Two explicitly gay women, that queerness ties directly into the story. They don't just throw away lines mentioning a date they once had, these are integral parts of their character identity. It's two women who fight for love, one against a homophobic culture that would shun and exile her, and the other in memory of a lover that was taken from her. Overall, Iconoclasts is a wonderful game that impresses not only in gameplay, but in story and presentation as well. It's only $20, which is a steal for what you get out of it. The game also had a physical release with some extra goodies that I cry to sleep at night knowing I could never get. At the time of recording this, Konjak is working not only on another game, but supposedly a surprise for Iconoclasts fans. And while I'm super excited to see what the surprise will be, I'm even more excited for his next game, Pepperbee. From the looks of it, it's shaping up to be something special, and I'm sure whatever it is, it'll be great. And hell, if it's anywhere near the level of quality that Iconoclasts was, I'm sure it'll be fantastic.
We won't be sleeping in our own beds. We won't be sleeping in our own bed.
Hey, you made it to the end of the video. I know this one took a lot longer than expected and might not be everything you hoped for, but I still hope you really enjoyed it. Addressing the elephant in the room, my voice. I haven't been happy with my voice for years now at this point, and I want to change it to get to a position where I'm a lot more comfortable with it. You might notice that it fluctuates a lot or might sound a bit off, and I'm trying to work on that. Through the coming videos, it's probably gonna change a lot more. But trust me, in the end, it'll all be worth it. A happier me makes happier videos. Expect a bonus video a bit after this one, and then another unrelated one. This unrelated video is gonna be a bit longer than usual. I have something I really want to talk about. I know it's longer than the last one, but I genuinely hope you enjoyed it. And until next time, see ya!